Greetings, goblins. Jordan here. There's no pH, silent or otherwise. That's right, just like the air, we're phosphorus free. It's time for a little segment I'm going to call RCR-CBC-RPG, which, as we all know, stands for Read, Commentate, Review, Chapter by Chapter, Role-Playing Games. Cue the intro music.
Read, comment, review, chapter by chapter with you. A new RPG we can all referee. All my PDF folders accrue.
So this is going to be my long-form review segment where I read through an RPG and give my thoughts on what I like and dislike about it. If this format is something you enjoy, leave a comment and let me know what lesser-known RPG you want me to do next. As long as it's not one of the big two and it's not really expensive and I'm at least marginally interested in it, then there's probably a chance I'll do it. So without further ado, let's dive into mazes. Alright, so right off the bat we have a little blurb here. Mazes Fantasy Roleplaying Reforged. A modern take on the classic fantasy dungeon RPG. With a single polyhedral die and the power of your imagination, can you defeat the maze controller with swords, sorcery, and shadow? Lightning fast and easy to master, Mazes returns us to the dungeons where we first battled dragons with an award-winning, unique approach to fantasy roleplaying. Open the door to adventure, if you're brave enough. We've got some really cool art here that I think really evokes this sort of like 80s metal vibe. I really like it. It's really gets you into the headspace of what Mazes is about. And there you have the key and crown, two important features of the game. Mazes, fantasy role-playing. This one right here, this was my dream, my wish. Mouth. Nice, right off the bat, Goonies quote. A game by Chris O'Neill, powered by Polymorph. Now, I had never heard of Polymorph before I found Mazes, so maybe that's in some other games I'm not aware of, but I really like the layout of Mazes, the way it's set up. It's really easy to read. In fact, it's a fun read, which is why it's one of the first ones I'm focusing on. An invocation. Once upon a time, I took a roller coaster and found myself trapped in a magical and mysterious maze that was called a dungeon. I am as hopelessly lost in its labyrinth now as I was the first time that I faced the evil magic user Bargle, or fought the water weird as I explored the Dungeon of Dread. Mazes is a thoroughly new take on the venerable dungeon crawler. It is hewn from the very bones of the past. We take direction from the guides of Basic. We stole the grit and grime from the unearthed arcana. We explore tunnels filled with trolls, and the twisting passageways are the same caverns mapped out by Palladium and by the Arcanum. The strange beasts hail from Arduin, the glory imported from Glorantha. The tomes are borrowed from the libraries of Midkemia. From this dungeon deep, I have come to lay my offering upon the altar of the Fantasy Heartbreaker one last time. In many ways, Mazes is just a reformulation of an already discovered thing, an attempt to try and capture the magic spark of that original fantasy role-playing experience. In other ways, important ways, it is something new and exciting. I have spent much of the last decade playing with dice and ideas around a new, streamlined, elegant answer to many of the problems in role-playing, an answer that we call Polymorph. After the initial publication in ZineQuest and a host of other Polymorph games, what you hold in your hands is the definitive Mazes game. Simple role-playing rules for daring adventurers going down into dangerous dungeons to fight dragons with funny little dice. So, my stalwart companions, light your torches and take up your die. We venture into the maze. Chris O'Neill. A very succinct way to put it. I think this game is absolutely what it's laid out to be here. Here we have a pretty generic table of contents and a nice little map. Cool piece of art there. Rules for role-playing using polyhedral dice and the power of your imagination. Into the maze. I'm tempted to do like a percentage count of how many role-playing games that I read through that start off with what is role-playing or what is a role-playing game? So right now we're one for one. It's hard for little folk to escape his cunning mazes. Tolkien. Is this Dungeons and Dragons? There are dungeons. There might be dragons. There are definitely funny little dice. No, this isn't that specific game, but it is fantasy role-playing. This is Mazes Fantasy Role-Playing. Rules for adventurers entering the darkness in dangerous places, seeking treasure and glory. One of one. What is role-playing? Even if this is old hat, read on, as Mazes is a bit different from some of the other role-playing games that you've played before. If you don't know what any of this means, there is enough here to teach you how to play a game, though having a guide show you how to play is easier. We guarantee that this is a great game to start your role-playing journey with. Its rules are both elegant and simple. I would agree 100%. I think this is a great starter game, and I think this is a great game for whenever players call out last minute, but you still want to play something. I do think it's hilarious the premise that this might be your first introduction to role-playing ever, unless you have someone else who is like really pushing this game on you. I don't know how you would have found this very niche game before you found like D&D 5th edition or Pathfinder or something of the like, but I digress. Role-playing games are different than other types of games. What they are or aren't is something that is still hotly debated around nerd tables after nearly half a century. It's hard to tell where they start and end, if you're any good at them, or if it's even possible to be good at them. Opinions are murky on whether they should be balanced and fair, easy or hard. Just ask my comment section. There aren't really winners and losers. Oh, and almost no one agrees on what is or isn't a role-playing game, or if role-playing games are even games. Role-playing is playing a character under a set of rules that govern a world. The game is a set of rules that guide you through creating that character, exploring a space or theme with them, and hopefully telling stories with them. RPGs combine writing and action in a form that isn't like anything else. They aren't simply structured storytelling, they're also games. This idea will make more sense once you start playing. Telling a story together, playing a game to find out what happens. At the core of every role-playing game is the idea that we are playing to find out what happens, in a different way than a board game, a video game, or even other storytelling games. In a role-playing game, we have to play to find out. We don't just get to see what happens. We don't just know what will happen or get to say what will happen. We have to play to see what happens. When you are faced with a decision or an event, it's not always going to play out the way you want, or even the way that you expect. At their core, these games are about the thrill of success and failure in the midst of a growing, emergent narrative. Mazes is about exploring a fantasy world, a world rising up after a devastating catastrophe, a world that has moved on, and finding out where you fit into that world. As you play, you're going to share the creation of a story together, not through exposition, but through the actions of your characters. One player, called the Maze Controller or MC, leads the story. The MC guides the story, determining how everything in the world works and playing all of the characters not played by other players, known as non-player characters or NPCs. Thank you, TikTok, for forever ruining that term for me.
So NPC is like non-player character, okay? So MMO, like World of Warcraft, somebody like a quest giver.
They take on the role of the world, the monsters, and the mysteries that you'll face. You and the other players are the characters. Throughout your plays of Mazes, we expect you to play many characters. You may even take on the role of NPC. Please, for the rest of us MCs, do this. If you've never played a role-playing game before, it's usually best if someone with some experience acts as the MC for your first game. If this is your first RPG, welcome. We wish you all the best on your new journey. If this is your millionth RPG, welcome back. We hope that you find something new and exciting in these pages and these worlds. And I agree, I think you will find something new and exciting here. What do I need to play? You have in your hands all the rules that you will need to play. In addition to this book, each player will need some dice, specifically polyhedral dice, at least 1d4, d6, d8, and d10. It's best to have a few of each die type. In this game, only the players roll dice, but an MC may want a pair of D12s for tracking darkness and treasure. These are two of my favorite mechanics in this game. I don't know if we'll get into them in this segment, but in the next chapter for sure. You will need character sheets. You can download sheets and other accessories from ninthlevel.com/resources and some writing implements. While not necessary for gameplay, some players like to have paper or a journal. I think these are necessary for gameplay. Please have these. Please be good players and take notes of things your GM is saying. Some players will like to have paper or a journal on hand for taking notes and scribbling ideas and maps. We also like to use name cards, such as folded index cards, since we are often playing one-shot games at conventions and similar events. Yes, this is another great suggestion here. I often like to have folded index cards with the person's real name and then their character name underneath that, just because a lot of times it's people who've never played together, unless you're just an old group and I don't know why you're playing mazes, unless it's just your off week or something. But yeah, I love this idea. I pretty much do this even if the people kind of know each other, just to help everyone remember each other's character names. Lastly, we suggest using tokens, though again, these are not strictly necessary. The four most common tokens are hearts, stars, and horseshoes, clovers, treasure, and darkness. All of these can be tracked with paper and pencil, but there's something visceral and fun about seeing brass coins or crystal gems to represent treasure or watching literal hearts disappear. What should it look like? First, each of the players will create a character. Usually you are making a character for the present game, but you may create a group of characters and then decide which is being played later. It is best to have the players make characters together. During a game, the characters are going to go on an adventure. Mazes has very specific rules about how adventures work that are explained in more depth in Part 4 and Part 5, which we will get to later on. The maze controller will describe a scene to the players. Each player then has a chance to describe what their character does. Depending on their actions, the MC may ask the player to roll a die, pay a cost, or spend a resource. Over the course of an adventure, the players will take their characters through an expanding world. They may become rich and powerful, or they may die along the way. No matter what happens, the goal is to have a good time and tell engaging stories. Role-playing is more than just cooperative. It's communal. You aren't simply playing together to win. Your characters' lives are bound together. The expectations of mazes games are very different than those of most other fantasy role-playing games. Mazes is perfect for telling short, one-shot stories and for telling longer-term, multiple-part stories, but there's no expectation that the game will be played over a long campaign. Whether you are playing a one-shot or an adventure within a campaign, you should assume that an adventure will take 2 to 3 hours. Maybe this is nitpicky, but as a 35-year-old with a kid and a wife and a full-time job, I feel like 2 to 3 hours is kind of the modern standard. At least for me, gone are the days of playing like 4 to 5 to 8 hour game sessions. It's just not practical for my life. There are also modules or pre-created adventures to help you understand what a mazes game looks like. Another option is to watch some actual plays on the internet. Search for Maze's actual play on YouTube or the like, or whatever app you're using in the dystopian cyberpunk future. Alright, here's where we get into some of the flavor of the game, which I really enjoyed the sort of just broad brush level of it for a game like Maze's.
Welcome to the maze. The interior of the tower was a series of death traps. It ended long before I could thread the maze to my comrades. Glenn Cook, Black Company.
I have to use my narrator voice for this.
This is a broken age. There was a war, though none alive today remember it. Even an ilf with a century of years was born after the fall. There was an apocalypse. Mayhaps it was an endless series of wars, not a single Armageddon. A sorcerous war between witch kingdoms. A battle between brothers or races. A war of mad gods. We may never know. What is known is that there are ruins aplenty from that time, trinkets and treasures that tell of an age before, an age of power, an age of riches. These wars sundered kingdoms and shattered the ancient empire that once held sway from sea to sea. From its bones and ashes arose petty kingdoms and city-states that rose and fell as the strong women and men that built them passed. Dukes and countesses, barons and ladies claim land and hold sway in the wilds, or brave their way into the Badlands to take back terrain and forge new estates. Most villages are little more than armed camps built on the ruins of some other place lost to time. This is an age of mortals.
All right. Okay, I can't keep that up. That's going to kill my voice.
The elves of yore retreated into their fey realms, leaving only mixed bloodlines to remember them in burning eyes and colorful hair. The ancient dwarves diminished and died away, leaving only their sprawling tunnels as testament to their existence. The highborn and the mighty alike were cast down, and the world moved on, receding like a wave back into the sea. Humans and other lineages survived the chaos, and some even thrived. This was a time for the brutal and the cunning to rise. In the sorcerous torturings of reality, new people were born from that dying age without masters to bend knees to. The goblins left their caves to spread across the lands. The smallen folk took to the hills, and what was left of the elves set off wandering. This is an age of darkness. Serfs and slaves toil by day and fear the night. They say even the sun and the moons are dimmer than they once were. Monsters and beasts arise from the dark places. The fall of the times before hasn't stopped. Forces of darkness and entropy are still destroying the world. Strange men and fell beasts stalk and hunt across the land, some looking for the power of the past and others born from it. Dark souls seep from crypts and hunger to diminish the light. This is an age of ignorance and fear. Knowledge is scarce, learning even more so. Few can read, most are concerned only with putting bread in their mouths and finding a place to stay warm for one more night. Only a few understand magic or science, or even care to. Those that seek wisdom are just as likely to be called witches and cultists as scholars. Fear is paramount, strong swords are needed to keep order, and sharp minds to find justice. This is an age of the maze. As the pall of darkness spreads, evil spouts in the Badlands. The ancient ruins spit forth abominations. Dungeon gates locked by dwarf and elf break, releasing old gods. Unimaginable horrors created by witch kings of yore crawl out from their ancient pits, freed from the enchantments that bound them as those sorceries withered and fell. In this broken age, the gleaming halls of splendor and bounty have fallen into forgotten passages of dust and worn stone. These labyrinths, these mazes, are scrawled just beneath the surface of the world. Their dark paths are lost to memory and filled with peril. The brave and the wise venture forth to find answers and power in this benighted time. Within the ruins of the past, there are answers for those that seek them and riches for those cunning enough to return. Welcome to this world of mazes and monsters. Not that one. What is a maze? Life may be like a maze, but this is not life. This is a game, and a game is a dungeon. Chiron Gillian, die. A maze refers to any story where the characters are facing down a challenge of series of connected challenges. In many situations, this will be a literal underground dungeon of twisting corridors and passageways. A maze. But it can refer to any story the players undertake, as well as the location where the story happens. A dark forest, an ancient ruins, the back street of a city. This idea is in a lot of more modern RPGs, and I really like the idea that a maze or a dungeon doesn't necessarily have to be this subterranean ruins. It could be the estate of a noble lord, or the backstreet alleys of a winding city, or even, you know, treetop village with connected rope bridges of a place like something from Star Wars. Presented within this game is a brief sketch of a world that your games may take place in. In that world, the word maze has an additional meaning. Scattered across the world are the ruins of a previous civilization, a dark empire of evil witch kings and their monstrous servants. As they are uncovered, these deadly mazes attract powerful fighters and puissant? Am I saying that right?
Puissant. Puissant.
Puissant? As they are uncovered, these deadly mazes attract powerful fighters and puissant sorcerers to investigate them to claim their knowledge and riches. The door to adventure. Every game of mazes starts at the door into a dungeon.
The party has just lit their torches and are descending into the maze. What horrors and treasures await them? A fundamental principle of mazes is that we start every adventure as close to the action as possible. In a fantasy adventure game, this means starting at the door to adventure. The players are always about to step into the darkness of a cave mouth, walk down the stairs into a dungeon, or leap off the ship onto a strange island. This should be all in bold, in my opinion. I think this is one of the things that makes mazes really shine. I know this is a simple principle that could be added to any game, but if your game is going to be short-lived, like a one-shot, or maybe just multiple one-shots strung together, why not just put the characters at the door to the adventure? None of this, like, we meet in a tavern, meandering about, talking about our dead parents, whatever, blah, blah, blah. Just put them into the action and get them rolling dice and role-playing. Just start right at the door. I love this. Your characters don't spend any time traveling to their destination. They don't start with a shopping trip to collect supplies or researching ruins in the wizard's library. Games should never start in town, unless it's the street where the action starts, with you getting punched in the mouth. The cool parts of those experiences are handled differently in this game, as you will see when we explain darkness and treasure, which are two mechanics I really love again. For now, remember that we start each game opening the door to adventure. Swords Against the Darkness. The rules of mazes could be used to tell any kind of story, but specifically, everything herein is designed for the telling of a specific kind of story, one that we call Swords Against the Darkness, Blades in the Dark. The classes, edges, monsters, treasures, and lore presented throughout these books are all going to describe that kind of a game. A game where fighters, wizards, and thieves loot dungeons and fight monsters. It's about exploring forgotten caverns and ruins while avoiding perilous traps. It's not about shining knights and political intrigue, wandering bards, and chivalrous romance. The world used to be more civilized, more powerful, but that golden age of empire and magic has fallen. None still live who remember it. Society has broken apart, and the world is a patchwork of petty kingdoms, trading ports, blasted ruins. It is a dark world. But there is light to be found in the torches of your characters and shining off the edges of their blades in the dark. Your characters are a sword against the darkness, fighting against hopelessness and the reign of evil. It's about fighting for glory, for greed, and for self. In mazes, your characters are adventurers living in a dark and troubled world. They are wanderers and vagabonds that make their living raiding dungeons and ruins. Each maze is intended to be a simple dungeon crawl adventure that can be resolved in a few hours. Players can use flashbacks to go to town for supplies, research the evil monster, or accept a warrant for the arrest of the bandit lord, and the like. Each story can be self-contained, or an emergent narrative could occur, stringing your varied tales together. Advancement isn't the core function of mazes. There is no grinding out levels. These rules allow for an emergent story to develop, much like reading the fantasy novellas of the 60s and 70s, as opposed to the big fat fantasy novels of the 1980s and beyond, which were themselves so affected by role-playing game narratives. I will stop here to add a little criticism of this game. If there's one thing that drives me crazy about rules-like games, it's that there really is no options for character advancements a lot of the time. You know, some games are built where they say your character advancement really happens through magic items or through equipment, things like that, which is fine. You know, maybe you're just evoking a certain style of play. But if your party or your players are really enjoying mazes, why not have a supplement book that has options for advancement? I think that is maybe the downfall of most rules-like games. You could really keep the core of the mechanics and rules tight, but still add a few things for character advancement if that's where your story ends up going. Just one man's opinion. Rulings over rules? We hope that you find the rules in this tome easy to grok and use. They are a groundwork, not a comprehensive set of explanations for everything that might come to pass. This is by design. Part of the thrill of old-school role-playing was always the idea that you could try anything. Our hope is that these rules will give you all the tools that you need to adjudicate your actions in the game, and if they don't, that it will be easy for you to make a ruling to cover it. I do agree with this principle on the whole. I think that a lot of what gets under my skin about really robust rule systems that have rulings for literally every corner case imaginable is that it often stifles creativity and causes GMs who aren't creative and don't think outside of the box to just say no to a lot of things. I played in a lot of games where because there is a rule, and even if the person can't find it in that moment, they'll just say no. Now, of course, devil's advocate, the same can be said on the other side, and it really just depends player to player, or GM or MC to MC, whatever. But I find that more often than not, having a more richly defined and complex game makes GMs hesitant to make on-the-fly rulings because they're afraid that it's going to break the game further down the line, or that it's going to be in some way unbalanced, which, let's be real, almost every role-playing game is to an extent unbalanced. Again, that's just one goblin's opinion. Rolling the dice. He slunk along alleys and shadowed plazas until he came to the district which was his destination, the maze. Robert Howard, Rogues in the House. My role is my role. Each character is controlled through the use of a single die. They each have a role, R-O-L-E, which defines which die they roll, R-O-L-L. The choice of which die and the selection of some edges are the primary focus of making a character. There are four basic roles. Each role has distinct strengths and weaknesses based purely on the math of rolling that specific die. Now, before we get into the four roles, I'm going to scroll down and skip ahead a little bit and just look at the resolver. I just want this to be in the back of your mind as we go over the different roles and what they are good or not good at, and see how that's hard-baked into the math of what those target numbers are that you're trying to roll for each skill. So here in the resolver, we have the key, which is always your one, and that just represents, based on, I think, your background and edges, things that your character would be good at. So you will also succeed if you roll a one. Then we have books, which is all of your mental things like knowledges and perception, and those are a success if you roll a 2 or 3. So here you can already see how if you're a character who's rolling a d4, you'll probably succeed on like knowledge checks if you roll a 1, 2, or 3, which is 75% of the time. You also have your crown down here at the bottom, which if it's a 4 and there is light out and the darkness hasn't encroached on you, then you would succeed automatically on books. You wouldn't even need to roll the die with a d4. So just to continue our example here of these things to keep in the back of your mind, for boots, you're trying to roll a 3, 4, or 5. For blades, a 4, 5, 6, or 7. For bones, a 5, 6, 7, 8, or 9. And then, of course, if you're unable to reach certain numbers, like if you're a d4 trying to roll bones, you have to roll either a crown, or if it's something you'd be good at, your key. Okay, jumping back to rolls, which is one of my favorite things about mazes. Let's look at the four rolls. The four rolls. The Paragon is represented by the D4. The Vanguard is represented by the D6. The Fighter is represented by the D8. And the Sentinel is represented by the D10. Your die. Within a mazes game, only the players roll dice. The maze controller never rolls dice. Let's count how many times they remind us of this. The maze controller is both an impartial storyteller and the enemy of the party, but all actions in the game are player-facing. The MC doesn't attack the players. The players defend against the attacks of the monsters and traps in the maze. Depending on their role, each player will have a specific die to roll. You only ever roll your die. This die will be a D4, D6, D8, or D10. Each die has advantages and disadvantages built into it. No matter what happens, you will always only ever roll your die. If you are a D4, you always roll the D4. A D8, you roll the D8. Need to make an action? Roll your die. Effect roll, roll your die. We get it. There are three core types of rolls that you will make. An action roll, the save roll, and the effect roll. We'll come back to the effect roll in a minute, as it's a little different than the others. Most actions are resolved by rolling a die to determine if you succeed or fail at that action. The success or failure of actions and save rolls is determined by rolling the static numbers of four types of actions, books, boots, blades, and bones, or two special results, the key and crown. You succeed on an action if you roll one of the numbers shown for that action type, which are the resolver numbers we just went over. When your character is good at something or the situation is favorable, they may gain a second die roll, which allows them to roll twice and succeed if only one of those rolls is a success. This is called advantage. If the odds are against them or they are lacking in an area, they also gain a second die roll, but they must roll two successes to succeed. This is called disadvantage. I just want to put a little asterisk here because we're used to the terms advantage and disadvantage, but in mazes, disadvantage works slightly different than what we're used to. I really like this version of disadvantage, maybe even a little better than the ones we're used to in like 5e or Shadow Dark, because you need two successes when you're at a disadvantage in order to succeed, which makes other players shine who are better at things and makes disadvantage more punishing. The action. Taking an action is a primary activity on a player's turn. An action or action roll is a roll that a player makes to do something that they want to do. Rolls are active. Making an action roll requires it to be your turn, and taking an action is the result of your turn. The player describes the action that their character is trying to take. The MC tells them what kind of action they need to roll against, books, boots, blades, or bones. Let's say that you are trying to run from a crab bear down a corridor. The MC says, roll boots, regardless of your die type. You roll it and you hope that you roll a 3, 4, or 5, the target numbers for boots, conveniently located on your character sheet. The save. Making a save is the primary character activity when it's the MC's turn. A save or saving roll is a roll made to avoid something that the MC is doing against them. A save is almost always taken off turn, unless it is in response to an action the player has just taken. For example, one of your characters wants to open a door. The MC asks them to make a boot save because the floor falls out from under them as soon as they open the door. Saving rolls are your response to things happening to you. The most common kind of save is a blade save, which will usually be what you will roll when you are being attacked. Remember, in mazes, the NC never rolls dice. So if a creature attacks you, we resolve that by having the player roll to save, not take damage, as opposed to the MC rolling to act, trying to inflict damage. Unlike actions, saves can happen anytime and do not use your turn. Here we have a nice picture of a Viking trudging through the snow with some kind of a bird flying over. The effect. An effect determines the impact of something that the player has done, such as damage. After some actions are successful and rare actions that fail, the MC will ask you to roll for the effect. The most common version of this effect roll is a damage roll during combat. Effect rolls are part of an action or save and can be affected by edges, just like any other roll. Sometimes an effect is simple. You've hit something with your sword. Roll effect to determine the amount of damage done. Sometimes it's more of a pointer for something like distance or scale. You throw the small folk adventurer up onto the ledge. Roll effect to see how far they go. Unlike actions and saves, effect rolls are not about trying to hit specific numbers, but about trying to get high numbers and making dice explode. This is an important distinction for effects. When you are rolling for effect, if you roll your crown, the highest number on your die, it results in the die exploding. When the die explodes, roll it again and add the results together. This larger number is the damage you do in combat. So while larger dice have a higher effect on average, smaller dice explode more often. I really like this as built into the core mechanics of the dice, and it really makes the D4 and the D6 more interesting choices. Vantage. The primary way that you can affect dice rolls in mazes is through vantage. Positive effects are advantaged, and negative effects are disadvantaged. When you have vantage, either good or bad, roll your die twice, or roll two of your die if you have them. This is one of my favorite things about flipping through mazes as a physical book. I really like that this summation of the rules is in a bold black box so that your eyes are just drawn to it if you're in the moment trying to remember that rule. If you have advantage, you succeed if either roll succeeds. If you have disadvantage, you only succeed if both rolls succeed. While vantaged, it's possible to have increased results. When rolling with advantage, if you succeed on both rolls, this is a critical and should result in a better outcome, at least giving you advantage on your effect roll. While rolling with disadvantage, if you fail on both rolls, this is a fumble and results in a worse than anticipated outcome. If you have advantage and succeed on both rolls, it's a critical. If you have disadvantage and fail on both rolls, it's a failure. You could also gain advantage and disadvantage on effect rolls. Since you are not rolling against a target number, vantage is handled differently. When you have advantage on an effect, roll an additional die and take the higher result. For a disadvantaged effect, roll twice and keep the lower result. So for effect rolls, this is more of the advantage-disadvantage we're used to from, again, games like 5e and Shadow Dark. If you have advantage on an effect roll, take the highest result. If you have disadvantage on an effect roll, take the lowest result. When you have multiple sources that could provide vantage, you still can only take one of them. They do not stack. You have advantage if any edge or situation would give it to you, even if more than one thing is giving you advantage. You have disadvantage in the same manner, so you always only roll one die, standard, or two dice, vantaged. Now, of course, you could house rule that if someone has double advantage or double disadvantage, they roll three, take the lowest, or three and need to succeed on all three if it's disadvantage, but that seems really steep, even for me. If you're in a situation where you have both advantage and disadvantage, they cancel each other out. Roll only one die. Pretty standard stuff. Nike, just do it. Players have a lot of power and control over what is going on in the game. They describe their actions to the maze controller, and the MC will either narrate what happens because of your character's choices and actions, or ask you to roll dice to see if it works. A central premise of mazes is that the characters are the heroes, or at least the protagonists of the story that they are in. As the pro tags, we assume that they have the requisite skills and abilities to succeed most of the time. When a character tries to do something that they should be able to do, it just happens. Don't waste time rolling dice. Warriors can take care of their weapons, wizards can read ancient tomes, robbers can steal, and hunters can smell game on the wind. If it's something your character can do, it's intrinsic to their class, so it's not interesting if they fail at it. Yeah, this is something that's in a lot of modern games or OSR kind of stuff, and I really like this. I feel like this should be in bold. This should be like the silver rule, if not the golden rule. If the outcome of failure isn't interesting, or if it's just something that your character should be able to do, you know, you're not being pursued by orcs or something like that, then just let them do it. There are going to be times when more interesting things are happening. Wait for those moments to create tension. Don't try to just falsely create tension by being like, you have to roll to open the door. Are there people chasing you? No. Do you have lockpicks? Yes. Sure, you're a thief, you unlock it. Asking questions like, can I do such and such, is often used as the basis for a dialogue with the MC about an environment or an acknowledgement that the character can do that thing. They are a way for a character to gain knowledge about their environment without rolling. This doesn't mean that nothing requires a roll. If there's a chance that they won't succeed, there should always be a roll. Now, just because they can or even should be able to do something doesn't mean they always will. Sometimes there will be a conflict or a chance that a character won't succeed. Just because they are hunters doesn't mean that they always return with game or can follow the trail. Just because they're wizards doesn't mean that they absolutely can decipher that ancient text, and so on. Yeah, this is the little asterisk in the point I just made. Sometimes, for story reasons or tension, you do want to make them have to roll for something. Usually I do this if there's some kind of pressure, like, you know, the temple is crumbling around you, or orcs are chasing you, whatever. Or maybe this is just a really strange and rare ancient set of runes that maybe your wizard shouldn't know. Then make them roll. When there is a chance that they could fail, or whenever they're being actively contested, roll the dice. It's a good simple way to put it. Example, as the monster slayer enters a room, the MC tells them that they see the spore of blood trolls. There is no roll. They are a hunter of monsters. They know common monster tracks and how to spot them. They're a witcher. Now, if the player wants to track the trolls, the MC may call for a books roll if the tracks are hard to read, or a boots roll to keep up with the troll. Seven resolutions. Books, boots, blades, and bones. At the most basic level, when you take an action or make a save, you roll your die, attempting to roll one of the target numbers listed on your character sheet for one of the four core resolutions. Books, boots, blades, or bones. If that's not stuck in your head yet, I don't know how many more times they're going to say it before it is. Because of the distribution of these numbers, each of the rolls is more or less likely to roll them, resulting in each role behaving differently in the game. We will go into this more in the next section. Okay, this is the part of the game I didn't explain super well in my sort of broad brush video talking about things like chance and mechanics, but this is one of the things I really like about mazes right here. Books. Roll books when you are testing knowledge, perception, and mental powers. Books also cover anything sensory, listening, seeing, remembering. When you're trying to roll books, you want to roll a 2 or a 3. The Paragon, D4, is the best at rolling books. Play a D4 if you want to be knowledgeable, smart, or perceptive. Boots. Roll boots when you're testing any physical movements or athletic activity. Running, jumping, sliding, dodging, skulking. Boots are a character's reflexes, their agility and dexterity. When a character is testing boots, they need to roll a 3, 4, or 5. The Vanguard D6 is the best at rolling boots. Play a D6 if you want to be fast, agile, or sneaky. Blades. Roll blades whenever you are testing a violent action, whether or not you're actually using a blade. This can be any type of attack, barehanded, with a weapon, or with a spell. If you're trying to hurt something, or avoid being hurt, then you want to roll blades. When testing blades, you need to roll a 4, 5, 6, or 7. The Fighter, D8, is the best at blades, being more accurate than the Sentinel, who does more damage. Play a D8 if you want to focus on offense. Bones. Roll against bones whenever you need to steel your resolve or resist pain and disease. Bones is both your body's health and your overall strength and endurance. Roll against bones to save versus poisons or to avoid getting sleepy during an all-night watch. When testing bones, you need to roll a 5, 6, 7, 8, or 9. The Sentinel D10 is the best at rolling bones. Play a D10 if you want to dish out damage and focus on defense. For you smart players out there, a note about the Paragon. You may have noticed that a Paragon can't roll bones naturally. They need a special resolution instead. See Key and Crown. Key and Crown. While you're making rolls against the four actions, there are two special results that may come up. These are shown on your character sheet, the Key and the Crown. Your key represents your core self, the sum of your knowledge and capability. The crown is flexible, the top of your die, and it can result in success or failure based on outside influences. The way I like to think of the key is it's sort of like your proficiencies or skills in other games. You're not always going to roll it, but it is just like one more higher percentage chance that you are able to do that thing. Whenever you roll a 1, if the action is something that your class or aspect can do, it's a success. This is the key bonus. A key result is not like the other resolutions in that it's a bonus, not a direct roll. You don't try to roll your key. Example. Let's say that your party is looking for a thief in a crowded room. The MC calls for a books roll. Normally, you would only succeed if you rolled a 2 or 3, but if you're playing a character whose class would be good at spotting a thief in a crowded room, like a talented thief, another thief, or a knockabout ranger, then you would also succeed if you roll a 1. Crown. Every die has a crown. The highest number that the die could roll, a 4 for the D4, a 10 for the D10, etc. When you roll the crown on your die, what happens is based on the current darkness. When rolling a crown, if things are currently bright, you succeed. If darkness is currently bleak, then you fail. While it is torchlit, you can succeed, but will have to pay a cost. This is something that will get explained in a later chapter, but I really like the effect and the presence darkness has as a sort of meta mechanic or a meta currency. You'll see later on, but it's something that you can evoke as the MC whenever certain things happen. Like your players are just sitting at the door for too long, or like enemies show up. Suddenly the darkness level rises. It kind of reminds me of, if you've ever played Darkest Dungeon, the way the torches kind of work in that game. Always count successes before looking at your crown. If you roll a 4 on a boots test, it's a success, regardless of whether it's a crown for your die or not. Your roll succeeds because you rolled boots. This also means that while it is bleak where players fail on crown rolls, the Paragon would still succeed on a boots roll with a roll of 4 because it's a boots success. Example. Iron Wolf is a Vanguard D6 intrepid ranger who is trying to dodge through a hall crowded with bugbears. She rolls boots to dodge through the crowd and rolls a 6, her crown. She needed to roll a 3, 4, or 5 to succeed normally. If she had rolled a 1, it would have succeeded as well, since her class is Intrepid Ranger, and running seems like something she could do. Since the darkness is currently torchlit, she can negotiate a success with the MC. Iron Wolf says, I get through the bugbears, but one of them takes a swing at me with his maul. Later, when a similar event occurs and the darkness is bleak, she would fail. Chaos. There will always come a time when one of the standard options for actions and saves doesn't quite work, where the outcome is still dictated by chance, but the core of the action can't be directly attributed to a character's strengths or weaknesses. Chaos rolls can be used for other effects when a die roll would make something too easy, and it keeps the maze controller from ever needing to roll a die. Don't you dare roll dice, you maze controllers. In these situations, you can make a chaos roll. On a chaos roll or save, the character is successful on any even results and fails on any odd results. This is a good rule that I sometimes implement when I need a yes or no answer. Example uses for chaos saves and rolls. Saves against random effects, determining who gets hit by a trap, stumbling around in the dark, determining the random recipient of a monster's attention, success and failure at true games of chance, if you're not cheating. Okay, here's the resolver, which I went over earlier, but I'll scroll through, and here you can see there's a chaos roll. Here's advantage and disadvantage. Rolls and rolls, as if we haven't made this pun enough. A great party is a mix of different roles, where all of the players are providing different skills and expertise while all being good at specific types of actions. Someone provides the offense while someone else plays defense. Someone should be mobile while someone else provides utility. While there are an endless combination of character concepts, classes, and backgrounds, there are only 4 roles. By combining a role with your other options, you will create a unique play experience. Your choice of role will determine what types of actions that you will be most successful at, and therefore will focus your activities. As a player, you should choose the role that will support what you like to do in games. So there's 2 things I want to bring up real quick right here. A lot of times I'll see things like people saying, oh, well, if there's only like 4 roles or classes, that doesn't sound like a very robust game. You're only going to have a couple of things you can do. Well, they're going to go over it in a second here, but you could play a like fighter type character who's a paragon and only rolls a d4, which means that their dice explode more often and they're more likely to do the things they're specifically good at. So there actually are quite a few options here for builds, and including things like edges and background. It ends up being a fairly robust character creator where you can accomplish lots of different styles and archetypes of characters. The second thing I want to note here is I really like this style for games like Mazes, where a role encompasses your style of play. Sometimes you pick a class because you have this idea of what it's going to be in your head, and it ends up not really being that thing. Well, with the roles in Mazes, if you want to be a tough, tanky kind of character, then you play a sentinel. If you want to be up in the action fighting, then you play a fighter. If you want to be someone who's like a skillful rogue, then you play the vanguard. It's a very different approach to the way that you create characters, and I really like this aspect of Mazes. Choose your role based on what you want to do in the game. Then choose a class based on how you want to do that thing. It's totally okay to be a sorcery fighter, a shadow sentinel, or a sword paragon. Remember, you will be most successful when you choose a role that matches what you want to do. If you want to beat things up, play a fighter. Picking paragon and then trying to beat things up will be less fun. In Mazes, we describe roles mechanically by assigning each player a specific die. Okay, I think this is where it really gets into the meat of the different roles. So really pay attention and think about those resolutions or resolvers that we saw earlier. The paragon. Seize the D4, paragon. This is your die. You are the expert. You are the smallest die, but it explodes the most. You have 4 hearts, not a lot, and 4 stars, the most. The paragon is the most cerebral of the character roles, focusing on thinking, talking, and their senses over combat and action. The paragon uses their special skills more than other roles, and they shine when they are rolling against books. They are the best at what they do. They roll their key and crown far more than other roles, allowing them to succeed even in harsh situations. They have more stars than other roles, allowing them to take more direct control. I think this is important to remember, because if you're a sort of skill monkey kind of a character or player, and you prefer to have things like knowledge and to notice things, then in certain situations, the Paragon almost never fails at this. Because if it's your key and the crown is still a success for you, then that's a 100% roll on books. So something else I want to highlight here, I really love this section. I wish that every role-playing game had a sort of bullet point list like this that told what this class actually accomplishes and what it feels like to play it. This is one of my favorite things about mazes. You could just come to this bullet point list, decide what you want to do, and then go and make your choose your class and background and options like that. Choose the Paragon because you want to. Be the best at a class ability. Use your instincts and intelligence. Solve problems. Investigate and use perception. Talk a lot. Make decisions. Use special abilities rather than basic combat. The Paragon's weakness lies in their few hearts and combat roles in general. They are easy to hurt and require help or defense from other players. When a Paragon goes down, they are not likely to get up unscathed. Your strength lies in using your class abilities, your wisdom, your perception, and your mind. Secondarily, you are good at using your skills and knowledge. Your key is very important to this role, as you will be referencing it often. You take center stage when the story focuses on discovery, knowledge, and your particular skills.
The Vanguard. Snatch up the D6 Vanguard. This is your die. You are always at the forefront of the action. You have 6 hearts and 3 stars. A good mix.
This is probably my favorite class just because I feel like it accomplishes the sort of things I like to do as a player. The Vanguard is the most active of the character roles. They are pretty good at everything. Physical action, combat, and skills. They shine when they are rolling against books and boots. Choose a Vanguard because you want to. Always be in the thick of it. Use your instincts and intelligence. Be great at physical activities like running and climbing. Be a decent fighter, but are okay with not being the best at it. Use a blend of special abilities and basic combat. The Vanguard shines when the story focuses on action, especially if their edges are being called into play. By their nature, the Vanguard is a great fit to back up other characters. The Vanguard's biggest weakness is that everyone else is better than they are at most things, though everyone else also has bigger weaknesses.
The Fighter. Take up the D8, Fighter. This is your die. You are here to smash faces. You have 8 hearts and 2 stars. A good mix.
The Fighter takes center stage when the battle starts. They are at their best in combat scenes. The Fighter is always in the middle of the action during a battle, generally acting on the offensive. They shine when they are rolling blades. Choose the Fighter because you want to. Stab it, kill it, set it on fire. Be good at physical activities like climbing and swimming. Survive a beating. Dish out some hurt. Focus primarily on basic combat. The Fighter is the most suited to living on the dark edge of the world of mazes. They are best in combat, but still capable in boots and bones situations. They are somewhat limited in the books department, but they do have 2 stars. The Fighter is better when they are surrounded by other character roles. Fighters are good solo characters, but they are also great team players. Your greatest strength is on the attack. A warrior type class with a fighter role is a beast in combat. Take center stage when violence is on the menu.
The Sentinel. The D10 awaits you, Sentinel. This is your die. You are the shield that guards the world's... guards the party.
You have 10 hearts, the most, but only 1 star, which means you are hard to stop, but lacking in depth. The Sentinel is the most defensive of the character roles. You are good in combat and especially good at brawn and health type tests. You do the most damage and have the greatest effect, but the Fighter is more accurate. Choose the Sentinel because you want to. Be safe and keep others safe. Be strong and hardy. Soak up damage and laugh at it. Defend the party. Deal the most damage. Focus primarily on basic combat and be on the defensive. The Sentinel is weakest when it comes to using their key ability and on books rolls. Unlike the Paragon, who strives to utilize their key bonus often, the Sentinel's key and crown come into play the least. Your strength is your staying power. You are strong, hale, and hard to take down. You can take conditions, spin hearts, and still be effective at most things. The Sentinel is the safest of the characters, but also the one that can deal the most devastating effects. This is actually another really cool class, and for people that really like to get into combat or be a tank, you'll see how this works a little better when we go over the hearts and the stars later on, which are two of your primary resources. I think this is going to be a main pick for a lot of people who are just here to fight things or to defend the other characters. Resources. All right, so I really wanted to get into the section about darkness and treasure and maybe some of the hearts and things like stars, but I might save that for the next video just because this is already running a little longer than I anticipated and because Juno just woke up and I've got to go be a good dad and take care of her. But if this is something you really enjoyed, don't forget to like the video, subscribe, hit a bell, blah, 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 you know, all the stuff. And do leave a comment, though, if there is a TTRPG that you'd like to see me read through in the future. I do have a building folder of PDFs that I'm probably going to go through first. But if there's one that you would like to be at the top of that list, or if enough people comment and say there's one that they would like to hear my dumb voice talk about, then I will put that towards the top of the list. But yeah, leave a comment. Tell me what that TTRPG is, and I will look into it. And if it's something I'm interested in reading, then I will add it to the list. So thank you guys for listening. Remember, make mistakes, choose chaos, and always have fun.
Read, comment, review, chapter by chapter with you. A new RPG we can all referee. All my PDF folders accrue.